For the longest time, I secretly wanted more. I often found myself shrinking to fit in, settling for what was comfortable, and even selling myself short. Once I finally accepted that we deserve success and we are blessed with the power to achieve it, I stopped playing small. I'm serious about building a life I love, and you should be too. I'm Denise Taylor of DeniseTaylor.live, and welcome to Life, Love, and the Pursuit of Happiness. I help women prioritize themselves, their success, and their happiness. Let's meet this week's achiever whose story will inspire you to push past your fears and soar. Well, hello, it's Denise Taylor. Always my pleasure to welcome you to Life, Love, and the Pursuit of Happiness. One of the greatest opportunities I get by sitting in this seat is a chance to meet and embrace and empower so many great voices and women and men that are rising to be leaders and to serve. And when I think of Demetrice Smith, and I think of truly how she has taken her pain and really magnified it into power, beyond just purpose, but power, I'm telling you, I am impressed with her more and more every time. You may recall that she and her husband spent some time with us at a recent event that I hosted called Couples Love Week. And during Couples Love Week, they had a chance to share with us their experience and testimony, Footprints on My Heart. Now, we heard a lot about their journey into purpose, but today we're going to learn more about how Demetrice serves from purpose, which really exudes her power. I want you to listen for how she shakes off fear. Everything that she had to deal with was real. Her experiences were real, but she shook them all off. And I'm telling you, she's showing you what that black girl magic is all about. So take a listen and listen for how she shook off fear, and let it be a testimony to you that you can rise up to. Well, welcome to this episode of Life, Love, and the Pursuit of Happiness. And I am so excited to have Demetrice with us today. That beautiful smile, I'm telling you, she is about to share a whole lot of goodness to empower us as women and really own our health, own our experience. And I cannot wait to unpack everything that she does to serve women today. Now, today we're going to anchor in on happiness, which she might find that peculiar, but I selected happiness because Demetrice has absolutely turned her pain into purpose and her misery into mission. And it's happiness because it means the world to her to serve and truly honor the footprints on her heart. Now, not long ago, I had a chance to sit down with Demetrice and her husband, and we really unpacked and discovered so much more about their journey and their story. And that is a priceless episode. If you haven't listened to that, I definitely encourage you to do so. It's a story of courage. It's a very courageous story that she and her husband went through, but came out smiling with a glowing picture of beautiful children. But like I said, they carry footprints on their heart, and we'll discover a little bit about that today. So welcome, Demetrice, to Life, Love, and the Pursuit of Happiness. And before we jump in, why don't you tell our listeners a little bit more about you, and then we'll unpack more about Melanated Midwife.
Yes, Denise, thank you so much. I am humbled to be here and to be a part of your show. So just thank you for this opportunity. So like you said, my name is Demetrice Smith. I'm a nurse practitioner and a certified nurse midwife. I'm also a wife and a mom, a homeschool principal by default. If you have kids homeschooling with COVID, then you know what I'm talking about. But also, I just want to kind of just share a little bit about my journey. A labor and delivery nurse who unexpectedly went into preterm labor at 25 weeks and totally changed my life. When I went into preterm labor at 25 weeks, my baby girl delivered her, and she lived for 6 weeks and then passed away. And so that totally changed the trajectory of, you know, my husband and I, what we were dealing with, and then just so many things that just came out of that story. My sister was pregnant at the same time. And so that was definitely, you know, some triggers, some emotional things that were going on at the time, you know, between us. And then it just allowed me to use my pain to share with so many other women. And sharing my story helped me to not only heal myself, but to also help other people in their healing. And so that's really how Melanated Midwife and how my story really came to be, was through the pain that I experienced myself. And like I said, I'm a labor and delivery nurse by my first passion, also a nurse practitioner and a certified nurse midwife. So in my field, I come in contact with all different women. And so I do believe that God is very intentional about the things that he allows us to go through. And so I have actually experienced 4 different kinds of pregnancy losses, which I believe allows me to really connect with the clients, the clientele that I come in contact with, because I come in contact with, like I said, millions of all of these various women from various backgrounds. But the ones that I really, you know, I connect with them all, but the ones that I really connect with are the ones who are experiencing loss. Maybe they've had an ectopic pregnancy or a tubal pregnancy. Maybe they've had a miscarriage or a preterm birth or whatever that facet is that connects us. I'm then able to share my story and get people to really open up and talk about their feelings, or maybe even validate some feelings that they're having themselves. So this is really where my ministry and my passion came in so much. And I'm elated because so many people don't get to work in an area that they feel really strongly about, that's aligned with their purpose. And I get to experience that every day. So I am beyond blessed. I probably wouldn't have picked this path to go down if I had my own choice. But with that being said, I wouldn't be the person that I am today had I not experienced the things that I've gone through thus far.
Yeah. And I think that's incredible, because the experiences that you had, they definitely tapped into a painful nature, right? It wasn't like this was birthed out of some excitement. This was birthed out of pain. And the fact that you could translate that and take it from where you are and what you've experienced, but find something good in it to move forward so that you could still be a blessing and serve others, I think is tremendously beautiful. And Melanated Midwife, you know, it has so much meaning, which we'll dive in today. And it, like, you didn't just stumble on this. You did research to let you know, where you need to target and what you needed to do. And I think that is the impressive part. But tell us about Melanated Midwife from a standpoint of how you serve.
Okay. So Melanated Midwife, it serves in 3 main areas for sure. But what Melanated Midwife is that I wanted Black and Brown women to be empowered through education and to really be able to take ownership of their pregnancy and wellness journeys. And like I said, for me, having the experience of so many adverse outcomes during pregnancy, you know, helped me to kind of birth this ministry. But then it also allowed me to see not just the data that I look at every day that says, you know, Black women are 3 to 5 times more likely to have these adverse outcomes, but to really see, like, when I had these experiences, that so many people in my circle started coming forth, like, hey, like, I had this too, or I've had a preterm loss, or I had a miscarriage. And I was like, I never knew any of that prior to my own experience. And it just showed me that so many of us and so many Black women tend to suffer in silence. And so I was like, no, there is a better way that we can heal through, you know, without silence. And then, and a big part of my journey, I love to teach. And so a big part of that is me teaching. So what can I do to give back to women? How can I help empower them through their own pregnancy and wellness journey? So a big part of that is actually teaching. So Melanated Midwife is actually an evidence-based prenatal course. It targets pregnancy, preconception health, so health before pregnancy, the pregnancy journey itself, But then it also tackles and taps into those things that are more likely to come about for Black and Brown women. So maybe it's like your gestational diabetes that, or, you know, diabetes that you get during pregnancy. It could be high blood pressure. So we actually tap into those things that you are more likely to encounter as a Black woman or a Brown woman, and the things that you are more likely to encounter. And those are the things that are killing our Black moms. And so I really want, the purpose of it was to really educate moms to know upfront, hey, if you're experiencing these signs and symptoms, these are things that are common, but these are the things I need you to know. So if you need to act, we need to, you know, go to the hospital and get, you know, be really proactive in your care. And not to just, you know, to hone in on these things to where you can actually be an active participant in your care. So, you know, not to just say, hey, you know, just go with the flow with whatever it is that your provider is telling you, but take ownership of that pregnancy journey. If you have questions, you know, ask them. You should be asking your providers questions. And so giving them the base and the information to really say, hey, is this normal? You know, what about this? Or, you know, or maybe have we, can we consider this to really take ownership and partnership with that? And then a big focus too is, unfortunately, is that we have to focus on patient advocacy, because a lot of underlying racism, you know, is within our hospital system. And it goes back to, you know, dated to slavery when, you know, the slave masters were practicing PAPs and C-sections on slave women. And so it's a long standing history. And unfortunately, a lot of our Black and Brown moms get the brunt of this underlying racism and this implicit bias that we have within our hospital systems today. And so it's really teaching mom, in addition to knowing, okay, this is normal, this is not normal, and then this is what implicit bias looks like, and what do we do about it? Mm-hmm. So really showing moms, and I like to do it as family. So not just mom, but whoever your partner is or your support person is going to be, have them join us, because I need both of you to know how to advocate. Because if mom's in labor, she's maybe, you know, dealing with painful contractions, or maybe she has an epidural or whatever it is that's going on with her, she may not have the capacity to advocate for herself. So I need somebody there that can advocate. So I teach on advocacy to know, okay, if X, Y, and Z is going on, how can I navigate through this hospital system to get what I need? Who can I contact if my nurse isn't doing right? Okay, so then you call the charge nurse. So the charge nurse comes in and you're still not getting your answers. Well, we can call that hospital advocacy department. And so I teach clients to really, you know, the proper steps and the channels to go through to navigate through the hospital system. So that's a big, big part of the consumer piece. So not only do you get the basic education, you know, from your prenatal courses, you get the things that that certainly affect Black and Brown women, you know, all the warning signs, and then that big push of advocacy. And then one more little piece that I like to add for just to reconnect back to our cultural roots, because we have so much gotten away from it. And this was actually inspired by one of my girlfriends. She has a course called Grandma's Hands. And so it's a herbal course for like in the postpartum period. And so I actually incorporate some of those teachings to show, you know, what are the things that we've gotten away from in that postpartum period. You know, what are the things that your big mom told you to do, you know, because we have a baby and the next week we're out and running around and things like this. And so it actually connects you back to your roots and teaches you those old Southern traditions of how to really take care of your body and to get your body back, you know, to his current health state or a better health state than what you were pre-pregnancy. So that's the fun part at the end that you'll get with those Melanated Midwife classes. So look, that's one aspect of Melanated Midwife. And like I said, it was two other ones.
Yeah, we'll jump into those. My goodness, that was a lot. And, you know, I think back to my own recent experience around with my mom and when she was in the hospital. And certainly the circumstances were different, but one of the things that rang out to me that you talked about is the advocacy. You know, mm-hmm. she's elder in age. And so as they were coming in and explaining different things, she just didn't have the awareness to be able to follow. And so it was really valuable for me to be there so yes. that I could yes. be that advocate, so that I could be that voice. Yeah. Yeah. And so it's a lot of things that I didn't understand in terms of the hospital system, but mm-hmm. I understood them in terms of what my professional experience mm-hmm. is. And mm-hmm. so that helped me navigate. And it was so funny because there was multiple times that after I would explain certain things, mm-hmm. the doctors and nurses would turn to me and say, "What field are you in?" You know, I took on the responsibility of making sure I knew and right, that I understood right. and that I could right. speak. And so I think that type of awareness is increasingly important mm-hmm. when you're trying to bring a life into a world. Right. Absolutely. So absolutely. I think that is, it's pretty powerful, the educational piece of what you're sharing. You know, one of the things that I want to go back to really quickly, because I don't want to overplay it, is when you talk about women suffering in silence. Mm-hmm. Because one of the things that you noted was that people came forward mm-hmm. after your mm-hmm. unfortunate events had mm-hmm. occurred, right? Mm-hmm. There wasn't this pre-awareness. There wasn't this conversation of what you should look for or right. what you should take note of, or, you know, all of the educational aspects right. that you're showing up with today. So let's talk about that suffering in silence and help us understand that as you discovered it from your own experience.
Yeah. And so, you know, as I mentioned earlier, you know, Black women are 3 to 5 times more likely to have these adverse outcomes. So whether it's miscarriage, preterm labor, even, you know, birth up to 1 year, 1 year post-birth, Black women are 3 to 5 times more likely to experience these negative outcomes, and Black infants, Black babies, are more likely to experience these negative outcomes as well, up to 1 year post-birth. And we are more likely to experience these outcomes regardless of our educational level or our social economic level. And research has been done to show that, and it's just so crazy that Black women are experiencing this, even if you have a doctorate degree, or you have, you know, I don't know, you know, you're very wealthy or well-to-do and you're going to all of your prenatal appointments, you are still more likely to have an adverse outcome lower, you know, greater than somebody who is of a Caucasian descent who lives below the poverty line. And so that is just absurd. And so we know that the numbers are there and that women are having these adverse outcomes. But I don't know if it's like culturally or, but they're just, these things are just not really talked about. And it does, it alienates us and it puts us into these silos. But it doesn't allow us to heal. It only lets us carry that grief and carry that burden around with us, to where if we were actually to talk to other people, and even if you talk to a lot of moms now who maybe have had, you know, gone on to have other kids and, you know, and extend their families, but they still may be dealing with grief of a previous loss that they've never acknowledged. And so I just think today, you know, and like I said, even with my own journey, like really close family members and close friends that came forward after the fact, you know, when I had experienced a loss, or after I had a preterm birth and, you know, she lived for 6 weeks and passed away. Like, I never knew any of this, anybody else's, you know, history up until then. Is always like, oh, you had a baby, things were great, it's wonderful. And so you only hear the good things, and I never heard any of the bad stuff. And like I said, it wasn't until I experienced my own journey itself, myself, that people actually started to come forth and say these things. And I was like, well, why didn't you say something before? And it's like, well, it's just not something that I talk about. So now I tell everybody, so especially if it's somebody that's newly pregnant, even if you've had a baby before, hey, look, these are some of the things, you know, this is common. These are some of the things you need to look out for. And just to really just have the conversation and let them know. And I don't do it to scare people, but I need you to be aware. So if something is going on, then you can take action and not wait, because a lot of times, even if it's something that's starting up, we may can prevent it from escalating to something worse if you know what the things are to catch them in time. And so that's the real purpose behind my mission, because I don't want people to suffer in silence. I encourage everybody, especially if you've had some type of adverse outcome, because you know you may have had an adverse outcome, or you probably know somebody who did. You know, so to really, you know, come forward, talk to those people. And then I'm a big advocate for, you know, mental health counseling. And that's, you know, have been taboo. It's changing. But, you know, for a lot of people, they're like, oh, I'm not crazy. I don't need to go and talk to anybody. But I am a big proponent of mental health counseling, because it is, you know, somebody who can speak to you on a professional level, you know, and can kind of help shift some of those mindsets and can help you through that grief process. Because if you don't acknowledge those feelings, they don't go away. You just, they just show up in some kind of other way, and usually some kind of unhealthy way. So we need to make sure that we're talking about it. We acknowledge those feelings and that we don't have to suffer alone. And it's like so many people that want to help you when you're experiencing some type of, you know, negative outcome, but a lot of times they don't know how to help you. So the conversation altogether can help that person who's actually experiencing that negative outcome and the person who wants to support you in that area. So it works both ways.
Yeah, absolutely. And so I think one of the things that is most captivating to me, and though alarming at the same time, is when we start talking about the disparity in healthcare and wellness care for African-American women, brown women, as you've discussed, compared to Caucasian counterparts. You know, that is very compelling because it seems to supersede educational perspectives. Help us understand a little bit about the factors from your own research, maybe, that kind of come into play with that.
Yeah. So a lot of it, when we go back and we look at the research and we see, you know, what is the difference? What are really the driving factors behind this? Because it used to be like, oh, you know, or maybe, you know, this mom maybe had a substance use disorder, or, you know, maybe they're below the poverty line. Maybe they're not coming to their prenatal appointments. But then when they really go back and they look at the statistics and they look, no, like these are well-educated women coming in. The only thing that is different is the color of their skin. So what really is it about the color of my skin that's making me so much more at risk than my white counterparts? And so the only thing that really stood out and came to play was systemic racism. And so it's because we deal with so many microaggressions on a daily basis. Most of the time, you know, they just kind of roll off the shoulders because we deal with them so much. You know, it could be something on TV, and especially now within this last year, you know, it was a lot with the Black Lives Matter movement, you know, George Floyd, just so many different things. And it's like every time you turn around, it's so many things that kind of hit you all at once. And so even if that person is not in your immediate family, just the significance of it all still impacts you and still weighs on you. So those stigmas are not stigmas, but those stressors we carry with us, and we carry them in our body. So maybe we don't even verbalize it, or maybe we don't even think how much it affects us, or maybe we don't know how much it affects us, but it does. And those stressors increase, you know, hormones within our bodies. They can increase hormones so much so to where, you know, it can cause you to go to preterm labor. If they are not dealt with, it can also, you know, you always say, you know, what mom feels, the baby feels as well. And so it can cause your baby to, you know, to be on a heightened state as well. And so those are the stressors that we deal with on a daily basis. And in addition to those systemic racism stressors, a lot of the times, you know, we are more prone to have these health disparities. So as I mentioned before, you know, these chronic diseases. So like you maybe, you know, have high blood pressure or have hypertension. You may have gestational diabetes. A big one in the Black community is sickle cell and lupus. So those things really affect pregnancies and make you more at risk for pregnancy. So that's why I do a course on preconception health. What can I do before I get pregnant? to improve my chances of having a better outcome. So those are the type of things, you know, to address in those stressors and those health disparities that we talk about, you know, to make sure that you're at your best before you get pregnant. And then, you know, having that mental health, you know, person there for emotional wellness, you know, to speak to somebody to that degree, and then really knowing how to advocate through the system, because these stressors, I don't think are going away anytime soon. And so it's on our part, it'd be prudent on our part just to know how to navigate and deal with these things.
You know, it's interesting. You know, clearly my kids are young adults, right? So I was not with child during the last year. But I feel like even for myself, right? Mm-hmm. When I got to maybe like September or October, mm-hmm. I felt like I finally took a breath of air. And I really didn't even understand how everything was impacting me mm-hmm. until I got to that time frame, you know, a few months past everything that occurred. Mm-hmm. And I looked back over mm-hmm. how I was functioning during that time. And it definitely was very subpar, very robotic. Mm-hmm. You know, I felt like I was just kind of going through the motions. Mm-hmm. I was feeling everything that was going on, but I was still trying to just yeah. be and yeah. do. Mm-hmm. And it certainly impacted me way more than yeah. I realized at the time. And so when I hear you talk about those things, I can look at my own experience and say, for that period of time, I was not at my best. Mm-hmm. I was not functioning at mm-hmm. any optimal levels at mm-hmm. all. I was kind of like in a haze almost. Mm-hmm. And so the reality of those stressors is completely real mm-hmm. because we as Black women, as a Black community, mm-hmm. for so long have just tried to keep on keeping on, right? Absolutely. And that when things are happening, you know, we acknowledge it, we have pain with it. We may even lash out. We might put a post up that says mm-hmm. all our rights matter, right? Or whatever right, the case right. may be. But the reality is there is an internalization that happens mm-hmm. with those experiences. Mm-hmm. And I can only imagine what that does with a mom, what mm-hmm. that does with someone who is trying to do the best that they can mm-hmm. to stay on point across mm-hmm. all aspects of who they are mm-hmm. and bring this child to life, because I know those external factors impacted me, right? Yes. I know that they did. Mm-hmm. And so I think keeping a pulse on those things, because the reality is, and you and I both know it, those are the instances that just got publicized. Right. There are many instances that the community experiences from day to day yes. that are impactful, that does not make national headlines. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they don't even make the news, mm-hmm. but they still impact us. And so understanding how to navigate that, whether it's with therapy or yeah. support, like you mentioned, or proper mm-hmm. awareness for dealing with those emotions and grief, it has to be very paramount and important to this experience. And so I think what you're doing is so necessary, even when it's not a news flash like what we experienced in 2020, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. Because the day in and day out life has that undertone, and it's had it for a long time. And, mm-hmm. you know, I have to imagine, as you've pointed out, it has to be a factor, because we live and we swallow that bitter pill way mm-hmm. too often. Mm-hmm. And I can only imagine what it's doing as you are trying to, you know, bring this life forward. So mm-hmm. I think what you're honing in on is absolutely important. You mentioned pregnancy stressors. Now, I'm not fully educated on what they are and how they impact. I know we talked about these external factors, and I get that piece. Are there any other pregnancy stressors that come into play that we should give mind to?
So in addition, besides the race, you know, those racial micro stressors that that definitely impact us on a daily basis, the other stressors would be more of your medical, you know, your medical history, really knowing your past history. So if you are a current diabetic, if you do have high blood pressure, if you have sickle cell or if you have lupus, those things will definitely affect the pregnancy differently, you know, or maybe it's somebody who has a mental health condition. So maybe, you know, bipolar or depression, anxiety, any of those things, because most of the times you will probably be on some type of medication for, and a lot of the medicines that you normally would take for those conditions are not safe to take during pregnancy. And so a lot of the times, especially, that's why preconception planning is so important. So a lot of times, if you know that you are planning a pregnancy or want to get pregnant, then we can switch you in advance. So if you do get pregnant, like, you're not on something that's going to be harmful to the baby. And why this is so important is because 50% of pregnancies in the United States are unplanned. So meaning by the time a woman misses her cycle, she is literally 4 weeks pregnant and all of the organs have formed by this time frame. So they're not all fully developed, but they're all formed. And so you can have so many things depending on, you know, if you're taking medicines that are not compatible with pregnancy or that's known to cause some type of birth defect. If you're taking that in the time that the organs are forming, then you're more likely to have some type of adversity, some type of birth defect or things like that, that can come into play. So those are the other stressors that I speak about, you know, in addition to, you know, our everyday stressors that come upon us. And then, you know, medically, what are we dealing with? What do we need to look out for? You know, family history wise, do I have something in my family that I need to be aware of, you know, to bring to the forefront that I need to be watching out for? Those are the kind of stressors, you know, that I speak of when I talk about pregnancy stressors.
So, you know, what's interesting, and as I was forming, you know, my questions to talk with you, I went back to my first pregnancy because I was trying to figure out what this pregnancy stressor was. I went back to my first pregnancy and I remember I was seeing an older white doctor, right? Mm-hmm. You know, he definitely was of grandpa age. I hate, you know, categorizing, but he was definitely of grandpa age and he was older. And every time I would go to see him, it would stress me out. Mm-hmm. And he would say things to me like, think thin, you're gaining too much weight. You should not gain more than, you know, 15 pounds with this entire, like, he was literally stressing me out. Mm-hmm. And so I was afraid to go to my visits. I was afraid for what he was going to say if I gained 2 pounds that week. And it wasn't like I gained a whole bunch. Yeah. Like, I might have gained like 20 to 25 pounds the whole pregnancy, but he really stressed me out to the point that when we got to maybe about month 6, I was like, I have to change doctors. And, you know, I'm just grateful that I recognize that that was causing stress for me. And, you know, of course, I didn't want to gain 50, 60 pounds. I understood that. And I understood the caution that he was trying to give. But going to the doctor, it was really stressing me out. And, you know, I'm just glad that I took the onus in that case to say, I can't deal with this anymore. And, you know, because at a certain cadence, it went from seeing you monthly to every 2 weeks to every week. To every week. Coming in here and I'm afraid of what you're going to walk in the room and say, you know. And I think, you know, us recognizing that we have to own our voice and be our own advocate and recognize what's happening to us and say, I can't do this anymore. And I'm just really, really glad that I did. And you know, like I said, he probably had well intentions, but just how he was coming across, it really was sending me over the edge.
Yeah. And I'm so glad that you did, because a lot of times it's so many women that, I don't know, maybe don't think that they can change providers. Like, you have every right to change providers. So I always tell people, like, ask open-ended questions up front. So you can know, you know, everybody's personalities don't quite gel together. So they may be a great doctor, like your doctor was probably a great doctor, but you know, your personalities don't mesh. Mm-hmm. And so you have every right to change providers if that person is, maybe their values aren't aligned with yours, or, you know, maybe they do things differently than how you want. Then you certainly have every right to change providers. And a lot of people will think, even that you were like 6 months pregnant, like, oh, I can't change providers. Yes, you can. You've had prenatal care, you know, up to this point, you can easily transfer to somebody else. And so the process is really that simple. Like, if I want to go to another provider, I can transfer my records and then I can start seeing another provider. But I would say, you know, vet who you are going to see, you know, where do they practice? Where do they deliver? How are their partners? So if they're not on call, then I may get one of their partners. So you have every right. So I'm glad that you advocated for yourself, you know, in that situation, to know that that was a major stressor. And look, and as you pointed out, I didn't even, you know, think about that at the time, but that weight factor is a huge, you know, stressor for people. And, you know, and just like we have biases within everything, there's still biases within the healthcare system. So even like the basal, your BMI rates and those weight charts and things like that, I always go, you know, I'm not a stickler for them. I go by, kind of use it as a guideline. But if you go over, like, it's not the end of the world. Well, let's use this as a guideline and not continue to stress people out about this weight thing, mm-hmm. but definitely use it as a talking point. Okay, let's talk about some nutrition things. What can we do differently? What are you doing, and emphasizing what they're doing right, mm-hmm. and how we can make some effective changes without stressing.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. So I love how you turned your pain into passion and have anchored around serving women, and specifically women of color. You talked about the three different ways. You talked about the educational track, which is powerful in and of itself. But the other two tracks are just as important. One is advocacy, right? And the other one is the subscription boxes, which I think is phenomenal. So help us understand more about the services that you provide as it relates to the subscription boxes, which I'm telling you, that is so key, and advocacy as well.
So I have subscription boxes that will go for every trimester of pregnancy. So it's four trimesters. So the first, second, third, and that fourth trimester is the first 3 months after birth, or after you've had your baby. So those boxes will be specifically curated for each trimester, but it will really emphasize the natural components. So they're natural, all natural products that's in there. So it could be a tea that's designed to help during pregnancy. You know, maybe it will reduce swelling and things like that to help with preeclampsia. We have a nausea tea. I have vaginal steaming herbs for in that fourth trimester. So I have... each box is, you know, curated for whatever that trimester may bring. And what I really love about it is that I am tapping into being very intentional about using Black-owned businesses. And so I'm using Black vendors for all of these products that are going into the boxes themselves, and to really, you know, help women to take ownership of their pregnancy journey and to really have things that will naturally help them in their pregnancy. And we're supporting Black-owned businesses as well. So,
you know what, I'm telling you, that has to be the best, like, bridal shower gift. I mean, not bridal shower gift. I mean, baby shower gift, you know, because yes. It is very sensitive and appropriate for what they are going through in mm-hmm. each of those timeframes. And so, mm-hmm. you know, I would just, you know, tell people to check that out, because yeah. we're always looking for something that mm-hmm. is meaningful. Mm-hmm. And, you know, everyone loves to receive those curated boxes because yeah. you just feel like you found a treasure.
Right.
And I think having someone like yourself really be intentional about mm-hmm. what's being put in there and why mm-hmm. it's being put in there, mm-hmm. I think is just a very phenomenal idea. So mm-hmm. I love it. All right. Now tell us about the advocacy and the support for students in women's health. Tell us what yes. you're doing there. I think this is incredible too.
So especially with the advocacy part for students, it's really been a longstanding thing that women's health is really one of those areas that is really hard to get into for a student, especially if you're a male student. It is very hard to get into just because it's very specialized. A lot of times it's not as many providers in the area who may be accepting of students to come in. And this was pre-COVID, like it was all of these, lack of providers, and it's definitely a lack of Black providers. And representation definitely matters. You want to see somebody that looks like you that's teaching in your field. You know, not a lot. You know, in addition to helping to take care of you, we need more Black providers to teach our students. And so pre-COVID, it was actually very hard to get into women's health and to get into OB. And like the ones who are still practicing post-COVID, because we're under so many different guidelines, whether, you know, we're limited to who can actually come into clinic, how many people can be there. And so they are really limiting these clinical experiences for students, and you need these clinical experiences in order to graduate. And so the ones that are providers that are practicing are being inundated with students right now, or our students are having to take a break or take a leave of absence, like from school, because they can't complete their hours. And I don't know, like, if you know how, like, most of the nurse practitioner programs or midwife programs, like the women's health is like you're almost next to last semester that you take before you graduate. So you don't want to get through all of your schooling and you get to the last semester before graduation and you can't complete your clinical hours and have to take an academic leave or whatever until you can get those hours completed. So what I really wanted to do is help students to have a place to where, okay, so let's think outside of the box. What can we do differently to help these students get some of these clinical hours? And so I offer simulated experiences to where, students and nurse practitioners and midwife students can still come. They can do skills, like a simulated skills lab. So I have different, mannequins and things like that, where they can do different skills labs. So maybe they need to learn how to do a pap smear. And so it's a lot easier to learn on a mannequin because you're not so scared to do a pap than when you're doing it on a real person. So, learning those skills, how to do a pap smear, how to do a breast exam. Maybe I need to learn the cardinal movements for birth or when a baby comes out, how the baby comes through the birth canal, so just really giving them a place to practice those simulated skills. And I love the simulated environment because it actually prepares you for the real thing. But it's a lot, well, I won't say less stressful, because I was still pretty stressed, like doing simulated things and having emergencies, but it's good to practice those emergencies in an environment. So if you do make a mistake, that's going to stay with you and it's going to stick. I'm like, okay, I know what to do if this happens. I do X, Y, and Z. So I think the simulated experience will definitely is helping students to still learn those skills and not to have to sit out another, semester or two until they're able to get those values. And then we also do like case studies and case scenarios. So, and documentation. So the students go through those notes and see, okay, so I have this patient, this is what they have going on. What are my diagnoses? What is my care plan? What are the things that I need to do for this client? And so to actually sit down and go through, those case plans, they have the clinical skills that will match it. And so it may not satisfy all of their clinical hours, but at least they won't have to sit out or you know, take an academic leave or something like that. So that was the purpose for that. The third advocacy piece was for students to really give them a place to where they can come. They can see other, you know, Black providers, you know, that are really trying to help and have a vested interest in their future.
Yeah, I think that's phenomenal because to me, it transcends the actual to do, and it's an excellent way that you're paying it forward. Mm-hmm. And you are using it as a channel to stimulate that representation that you talked mm-hmm. about and mm-hmm. stimulate that appropriate training yeah. and that appropriate response and that mm-hmm. appropriate voice and mm-hmm. all of those other dynamics that come into play. And I think by reaching them, the soon-to-be providers or the soon-to-be caregivers while they're still being educated and being mm-hmm. able to kind of put that melanated midwife stamp there, I think it's just phenomenal, you know, and I think it's an excellent way to pay it forward. And I find that to be just very impressive to be a part of your catalog. If experience in your daily work in labor and delivery field and all of that, it's incredible to believe you're going for your doctorate at the same time. You know, people talk about me and all the hats that I wear. My goodness, you are a mom, you are a wife. And when I say mom, you have four little bodies running around the house there, right? Four.
Well, three, four if you count the dog.
Okay.
Five if you count the husband.
And then on top of that, you're still working and serving in the labor and delivery field. You are still, you know, making it happen in this entrepreneur vein, and you're going for your doctorate degree. How in the heck do you balance it all?
Oh my goodness. Sometimes I ask myself that myself, and really, like, during COVID, I almost like had a meltdown because it felt so overwhelming with everything that was going on, you know, doing homeschool, doing my own school, you know, at home and working, still, you know, trying to be a wife and a mom. And it was just like all coming down. And I'm like, okay, this is not sustainable. What is going on? And so really having to look at and readjust and prioritize, take the things off of my plate that were not relevant. And I won't say that are not relevant because I think they're all relevant, but the things that could sit aside, you know, for now, and what are the things that are most important that I need to tackle? You know, family is always one of those things that has to be, you know, at the forefront. Because work will go on with or without you, but your family can't go on with or without you, right? So we have to kind of put and prioritize those things. And I had a good friend that she, when I was talking to her about just feeling overwhelmed, and so she was like, it's not balanced. She was like, harmonized, not balanced. She was like, so what works for you may not, you know, work for somebody else, but what is working for you right now? And so what I really had to do was just kind of go back and retake ownership of like the things that were just kind of pulling at me because I had really gotten off routine, gotten off schedule. And so really going back to, okay, let me start my morning routine. Let me get up and do my prayers, my workout, whatever I need to do in the morning to get my day started. And then really, you know, make the most of my time. So I don't necessarily like schedule everything out to the T. I may write those things down, but have time blocks to where I say, okay, I know I have this allotted time to do X, Y, and Z. So no playing around. And then I have scheduled, and this really had to be intentional on my part to put that family piece back in there because I love doing what I do and I can sit at my desk all day and, you know, and still do work and be fine with that. But then the rest of my family would be like, well, you've been doing this all day. So really having to, you know, put the time in and be intentional about family time. So whether that's, you know, watching movies and playing games as a family on Friday nights, having to make that extra time, that extra day to put in there for my husband to have his own date night and time. And so just being really intentional about, okay, at this time, I need to stop my work for the day and make sure that I'm spending some time with the people that I love most, you know, that I'm doing this for. So that's harmonizing for me and how it works. And so my husband is really great, especially if he knows, like, I have a deadline, if I have a paper to write or something like that. I'm like, hey, listen, I need to go and get this done, you know, make sure the kids stay down here so I can go do this. And so I have a great support system to help me with that. But it definitely takes some tweaking here and there. And so if it doesn't work, change, not being afraid to change the system.
I love the fact that they did offer the harmonious state, because I think we can overwhelm ourselves trying to discount something, take something out, and finding the right harmonious space is absolutely key. Now, I will tell you, when you started to tell me what your thesis was about, I was like, you have got to be kidding me. I was really blown away, right? Now, this is the heels of discussing everything that we talked about up at this point. And then when she got to her thesis, I thought to myself, oh my goodness, I don't even need to hear anymore. So give us a snippet of the thesis for your doctorate that you're working on.
Yes. So my thesis is actually opioid use disorders in pregnancy and provider stigmatization. So in addition to, like, legal penalties for women who are pregnant that may have substance use disorders or opioid use disorders, so they may face, you know, loss of custody or parental rights, maybe even jail time. But those are, you know, certainly deterrents of care. So if people, you know, maybe won't admit to drug use because of those things. But the second biggest factor that comes up to why women don't receive prenatal care or very inconsistent with prenatal care was provider stigmatization. And they come in contact with so many different disciplines within the healthcare system, you know, during pregnancy, that it's a total overhaul of the system that certainly needs to be done. And so that's what my research is on, is that provider stigmatization. What can we do to change the system? You know, how can we go in and get on a level playing field to say, okay, this is what patients who have been in this experience, because nobody wants to be addicted, you know, and it's really how you look at addiction will actually form those stigmatizations and those beliefs or those attitudes. And so if you look at addiction as more of a moral flaw, meaning that this person has a choice, they're only using because they want to, and this is their choice, they have something morally wrong with them, as opposed to looking at addiction to what it actually is, which is a neural brain disorder and also a mental health condition. And so if we look at it from that disease process, then people are usually more compassionate and have more empathy for the clients, and will not, you know, stigmatize them, and will actually include them in the care. And so we want to, and we know that this population is already vulnerable. You know, if you're just Black, period, we've already discussed the stressors and the things, you know, that you come against in pregnancy. So let alone if you have, you know, substance use or opiate use disorder on top of that. So we need you to come in for your prenatal care. You know, it's vital, you know, so we can catch things early if something is going on, you know, getting you the proper treatment and the resources that you need. So that's what really kind of drives my doctorate right now, because they always say, get something that is important to you and that interests you, because that will keep you motivated to keep going.
You know, that's incredible, because to me, you know, changing the lens of that in the way that all the work that you talked about being invested in up until this point, it really allows the rubber to hit the road when you look at the full gamut of what women are facing. And there is an opioid epidemic. There is certainly an epidemic. And so being able to say, I want to anchor in and do some research around here, and I want to try to influence the caregivers, the providers' perspective in understanding and implement practices to really truly first acknowledge what it really is and then come up with the right kind of care strategies. I'm telling you, if my mic wasn't so expensive, I would drop it on your behalf.
So I want to add something in there before we just switch gears real quick. And so even with just all of the stigmatizations that come along with opiate use or substance use itself, there still is a racial undertone that we still have to contend with that. So if we look at how the media often portrays drug use in America, so, you know, they often, when they see show Blacks or Latinos, they're often, you know, thinking about, you know, your heroin or, you know, crack addiction. They're often in drug houses, homeless, you know, have all of these negative things, right? Or you see them getting arrested. And so you have, and there's really no backstory behind it. But when we look at opioid use from the lens of white America, it's usually your suburban housewife who maybe, you know, had some type of surgery or car accident where she started taking pain narcotics that were prescribed to her. And then now she has this opioid addiction, right? And so we look at the things like two different ways. And so we may, and the care of how we treat people is not universal. Like, you should screen everybody that comes into your office for substance use, domestic violence, and other, you know, various things. But they would only, some people, I won't say everybody, but some people are only screening, you know, Black people, or they, you know, don't want to screen these white women because they have this fear that if I may offend them, and they may go to somebody else. Like, no, this should be done across the board, because drug use has no color boundaries. You know, it's rising across the board. And so that's one of the biggest things, too, that's in my paper and the research that I'm doing, is the lens that we actually view addiction and those implicit biases that we have. So we have to recognize where they come from in order to identify them. And so that's one of the things that's in the paper.
Oh, my gosh. It's just absolutely positively beautiful. Our time has been far spent. I am going to wrap this up, but I am intrigued by you. You have really devoted yourself and your life into making a blossoming, beautiful, invested flower out of every experience that you've had. And that, I'm telling you, is impressive. And thank you. Thank you for just sticking with your healing, sticking with your transformation, and sticking with your call, because it is going to make a difference in the lives that are going to be touched by the providers that you get to persuade. And so I appreciate that. Now, here at Life, Love, and the Pursuit of Happiness, we encourage you to build a life you love without apology. So we close out with our questions focused on those key aspects. Now, you got a chance to answer them before, and so you'll have a chance to answer them to again today in the context of what we're talking about. So here we go. If you could tell your younger self something about life, a life wisdom, what would you tell your younger self?
I would tell my younger self to dream big and don't let anybody, you know, dim your light. Have the audacious faith to go out there and do it. And other people will try to dim your light, and they may not have, you know, dreams of their own, or may think that your dreams are too big. Go for it. Cut out all the naysayers. And do it.
All right. And what about your love wisdom? What would you tell your younger self about love if you could?
Love. I would definitely tell my younger self about love is to, you know, go for what you want. Don't sell yourself short. You know, think about all the qualities that you have inside and what you bring to the table, and that you deserve to be here.
Absolutely. And then finally, it's happiness. What would you tell your younger self about happiness if you could?
about happiness, you know, still being your own narrator of your story. If you don't like it, change it, but making sure that you are authentic to yourself. And I recently read this devotion, and I think it's by Mark Todd. I'm not 100% on the author's name, so forgive me. But he said it was just so good that it said that God cannot bless who you pretend to be, only who he created you to be. And that touched me. So I'm like, oh my God.
That is good. Yeah. On that note, I do want to remind you, I told you before, and I say it even more today, success looks so good on you. You are such a bright, I'm telling you, you are a bright and shining star. And I really appreciate getting to know you even more every time we talk. So thank you so much for being my guest. And you always got me in your corner if you ever need me.
Oh, thank you. This was so much fun. Thank you so much for having me.
See what I mean? See what I mean? That magic was popping, okay? What I love about Demetrius is that she has continued to push the envelope more and more and more in how she serves from her place of pain to her place of purpose to her place of power. You go, girl. You keep embracing your power and go. And I just love the example of a rich heritage and legacy that you are creating for us. Oh, it gets me so pumped up. I hope that you heard how she just continues to shake off fear. She says it is false evidence appearing real. We know that is superpower number 3 that helps us be successful. I hope that today's testimony encourages you to go bigger, stronger, harder, so that you can indeed go further in achieving all that your heart's desire. You know what I say, you can build a life you love without apology. So don't hold back till you're living the life that you dream. Well, that's it, beautiful. Thank you for tuning in. Don't ever forget that you truly deserve life, love, and all the happiness your heart can hold. Be relentless in building a life you love without apology. I'm Denise Taylor, and you can always find me in our free Facebook community. Life, love, in the pursuit of happiness, easy to find. Now, if you want more information about my success superpowers, as I'm sure you do, download my free Success Superpowers ebook at denisetaylor.live/podcast. And one last thing, always embrace your power and go.